They generally say that in politics and diplomacy, if people begin understanding what you say, you have not been diplomatic enough. And the same goes as far as these meetings are concerned. Symbolism plays an important role. Therefore, as Dr. Ramkumar very rightly pointed out, it's very symbolic that the second informal round of meetings between Xi Jinping and Modi is taking place in Mahabalipuram. He has explained the importance of Mahabalipuram. We should also know the importance of Wuhan. The first meeting took place in Wuhan. And if you go into the history of 1947 to, say, 1975 to 80 onwards, it was not a very easy role. It was not a very easy and smooth ride for the first chairman of Chinese Communist Party, Mao. Mao faced a huge problem as far as his own engagement with PLA was concerned. So his issue of facing the People's Liberation Army was either you shake hands with them and share power with People's Liberation Army, or the second choice was to create greater power center so that the PLA is under control. So he had to face a coup. He invited PLA officers. All of them were called for a meeting in Wuhan. And as bad luck would have it, there was a major accident and all the PLA officers died. And this took place in Wuhan. So Wuhan actually symbolizes the strength of the person who holds the power center in China. And we should remember one thing, that Xi Jinping today wears three hats. He is the Secretary General of the party. The party did away with the post of chairman after the death of Mao. So he is the top person as far as the party is concerned. He is the army chief and is also the president, which gives him three exceptional powers which no other Chinese leader had enjoyed in these years. So, India is dealing with two power centers. One is the most powerful person, and two, the most powerful economy. As it was pointed out, if you consider the changing geopolitical dynamics, it has always been a race for supremacy. And if you look at the changing contours of these policies, what we realize is that the situational changes that has taken place as far as the world power structure is concerned, there is a major tectonic shift of power from the West to the East. There are four major economic powers today: the US, China, India, and Japan. In that order, three are on the Eastern Hemisphere: Japan, China, India. So this will lay the foundation for any futuristic strategy that both China and India would be preparing. So in this background, if we consider the first Wuhan summit that paved the way for not only greater engagement, but also rewriting the template for future engagement of these two countries vis-a-vis the world. Dr. Prabhakar explained the mandala theory. He also explained the inner circle and three circle theories of China. We both China and India, have a historical, civilizational past. And again, if you compare the Western and the Eastern hemispheres, it is the Eastern hemisphere which can claim ownership of 7 out of 9 major civilizations. Except for the Mayan and Aztec civilizations, all the rest of the civilizational strengths that the world has seen in these so many centuries are here. So out of this also, there are only 3 civilizations that have a longevity and continuity. The Iranian civilization, or what is called the later day Parsi civilization, is one of the oldest. The Chinese civilization and the Indian civilization. And in this, if you look at the continuity of the civilizational aspects, Iran does have continuity, China has continuity, but both China and Iran have different political dispensations. And also, they have been affected by different religious or irreligious groups. Iran today is a Muslim country. There is, again, we should understand the difference between Muslim country, Islamic country, and Arab country. So that's why I'm saying Muslim country. But Iran is probably the only country in the world, and Farsi is the only language in the world which continues to be the official language of the country of its origin since inception. That even India doesn't have. Sanskrit is not the official language. Incidentally, the Pallava language was Sanskrit and Tamil. So after the post-Pallava, the Sanskrit also saw a downfall for a very different reason. We will not go into those details. So this civilizational continuity, if you look at this, has these three aspects. These three civilizations have continuity. So looking at the whole issue of India-China relations from a very different dimension, we will have to also factor in the regional dynamics that are coming into play. And these regional dynamics have changed in the last 200 to 300 years. The regional dynamic was set by the colonial past. There was a time when colonies decided the strength of the region, strength of the country. So we have had great colonies, the French, the Portuguese, the Dutch, the English, the British. And the more land you hold, the stronger you are. Larger your colony is, bigger you are, more powerful you are. So power were the strength of the country, or the superpower, or what we call superpower today, was determined by the extent of geography that you hold. And then pre-First World War and the beginning of the 19th century, we saw the dismantling of the colonies. What began as the First World War slowly began to set in, and colonies began to shrink. Their hold on the geography began to shrink. And by the end of the Second World War, there was absolute dismantlization of the colonies. That's why Winston Churchill very famously said, "I do not want to preside over the liquidation of Her Majesty's empire." So these empires vanished. The first phase of the empire, the civilizational empires of Iran, China, India, they vanished and they gave place to colonies. The second empire, the colonial empire, was dismantled. And by the end of almost the Second World War, there was no colony, there were nation states. And then with the rise of nation states, there came a situation where polarities began to play a role. Civilization to empires, colonies, colonies to polarization. And then emerged a situation, a Cold War. After the end of the Second World War, there was a Cold War period which determined the two strategic powers, the poles, US and USSR. So this bipolarism became the most important aspect of determining the strength of the countries. After the end of Cold War and after the disintegration of USSR, the world faced into what we call the unipolar world structure, where the strategic world structure was determined by one country. And then from the polarities, then it again became bipolar, and from bipolar to unipolar, from unipolar to multipolar. And then among these polarities, there is a new structure which is evolving, which we are now studying in China Study Center, as Professor Prabhakar pointed out. A new polarity of tripolarity is developing. So this is the aspect, the tripolarity system, where we are discussing and debating the relationship between China and India vis-a-vis the region, dynamics of internal politics, dynamics of regional politics, and dynamics of global politics. So the tripolarity is one aspect that is going to really emerge as the most important element to study the structural behavior of these two countries. If we strategically look at the India-China relationship, the most important element that we have to take into consideration is the 1954 agreement, and then the 1962 aggression, and then the various incidents that became milestones in the relationship. So from what we would not very popularly but understandably easily to understand is the initial honeymoon phase between India and China. And then came around 1959 onwards, after the aggression that China committed in Tibet, and Dalai Lama had to, His Holiness the Dalai Lama had to come to India for seeking political asylum, there was a frozen period. And then from the frozen period, it was President K.R. Narayanan, and then Rajiv Gandhi, and then P.V. Narasimha Rao, and Atal Bihari Vajpayee. Up to this period was what we call the recovery period. And now what we see is from 2014, an acceleration phase. So this acceleration phase is what we are now discussing and witnessing, the prospects and challenges of this phase. It was in fact President Kennedy who very famously said that a day comes when great powers collapse. So we have to see this acceleration phase in the background of changing geopolitical dynamics and also the dismantling of the polarity that US enjoyed. Earlier speakers also pointed out about the challenges that we face in the region. So India is looking at the whole scenario from, again, the same three aspects: the internal dynamics, the regional dynamics, and the global dynamics. So if you go strictly from the internal dynamics, we know what the situation is, so we don't have to explain those things. But we will have to tweak our internal political situation, the social dynamics, and also the behavioral pattern of the society, the growth and evolution, economy, and so many other factors, all from the viewpoint of strengthening our pillars, be it democracy, be it media, be it economy, and so many other things. So if you look at the phase which we have covered from to say 2014 to 2018, I'm not taking 19 into the consideration because of the new election and then the new dispensation that we have. Continuation of the old dispensation with greater political power. So in this 14 to 18 period, we saw some of the policies that would lay probably the foundations for a stronger economic and social cohesion. Make in India and so many other things. And it was this period again where we consolidated our position as far as the regional institutions are concerned. The regional institutions are strengthened through bilateral and multilateral engagements and arrangements. So we have a security architecture, we have an economic architecture. Again, if you look at the region, this is probably the only region which is the most contiguous, but the most divergent. There used to be a professor of geopolitics in Australian University who used to say that the region is so contiguous that you sit in a cycle in Ankara, you can go up to Australia without really having to get down from the cycle. So that is the kind of contiguity you have. But look at the divergence, civilizational divergence, cultural divergence, religious divergence, political divergence, economic divergence, social divergence. Practically every kind of divergence. I'm not talking about the linguistic, because India alone has about more than 2,000 languages. Forget the other languages of the world. But in spite of all these divergence, we have certain opportunities that geography gives us. Geography has given us one of the biggest opportunity. In spite of so many divergence, we have the best opportunity to work together because of two very big oceans, the Indo-Pacific, which Commander mentioned, and the Indian Ocean. Indian Ocean encompasses something like 57 countries now, with Sudan dividing into two countries. From 56, it has gone to 57. With only 27 members as far as Indian Ocean Rim Association is concerned. If you look at the South-South cooperation, there are again 52 countries. If you look at Asia-Africa growth corridor, there are again 63 countries. So if you look at all these backgrounds and if you put all these things together, we are sitting on almost 70% of the world population and 80% of the world GDP. This is the gamut of the growth of these three civilizations. But of course, there are challenges. So when it comes to regional dynamics, what India will have to do is to strengthen these bilateral and multilateral security and economic arrangements. We have started working on some of these multilateral organizations like BIMSTEC. BIMSTEC, in comparison to ASEAN, BIMSTEC gives us a greater flexibility as far as movement of our strategy is concerned. Because BIMSTEC does not include China, BIMSTEC does not include Pakistan. But BIMSTEC includes Bhutan and Nepal because they are dependent on Bay of Bengal initiative. We have started reviving IPSA, which combines three important continents practically, and also three important democracies. India, Brazil, South Africa. We are also very active as far as Asia-Africa growth corridor is concerned. So these are some of the initiatives that India is now looking into as far as strengthening the regional engagement is concerned. And as far as the global engagement is concerned, again, we have our own strengths. Of course, we are a soft power. But in spite of being a soft power, we have demonstrated to the entire world that we can take hard decisions when it comes to reclaiming our own lost strategic space not only in the region, but also in the extended neighborhood. So if with this kind of strength, we are now in a better position to deal with the emerging security and strategic architecture, which keeps on changing. It was very rightly pointed out that India and China are not in a race for supremacy. They are not in the race for polarity. They are civilizational countries. Their civilizational existence, which has a continuity, which has a past, and which has a future. So we are working towards this future on the strengths and weaknesses of our civilizational past. So what should determine the collective growth and happiness of the region is a long-term peace which will not compromise with the strategy and security of these respective countries, but at the same time enhance the growth, security and strategy of the region and of the world, given the constraints and the extension of their respective worldview. So it is in this background that the first Wuhan meeting took place. It is in this background that the second India-China meeting would be taking place in Mahabalipuram. Lot of expectations have been earmarked and strategized. We would be able to make an assessment only of what happens after the meeting takes place. And since officially the meeting has not yet been announced, so we hope the official meeting would be announced after the actual meeting takes place, because it's an informal meeting. But I really commend the Citizens Forum for making this kind of a curtain raiser on this subject and giving us an opportunity.